Walls and curtains, the mystery continues. The soldiers put down their shovels at midnight. They didn't find the treasure. The soldiers set camp among the mounds of dirt and stone there and started drinking. Some of the neighbors joined in and passed bottles of wine and salami around. Soon they started singing. From our hideout we could hear the songs, drunken laughter, and snippets of conversation. "How long before we could leave the hideout?" said Shazzy, his voice trembling a little, which is why I left out the L. "My mother must be frantic. She has Ilfe in wolf mode," I said. "My father has unbuckled his belt already," said Schlezzy, not to be one-upped. We discussed, in a whisper, the downside of our perfect hideout. The problem was architectural. We couldn't leave until the bad guys did. We had to approach the question of hiding out from another angle. I suggested psychological, in the sense that the best hideout may not be, after all, a place. The best hideout may be mobile, in the sense that if we could anticipate from the time of day the comportment of the persons who are attempting to take us prisoner, we might outguess them by moving into the second place to where they might look for us. And if we then guessed the second place, we had plenty of time when they first missed to move to the third place, and so on, always staying one move ahead of our captors. This was chess, a game both Schlezzy and I were very good at, though we were not the world's greatest psychologists, as evidenced by the fact that we had been caught, whipped, and humiliated numerous times. We had some work to do if this kind of hideout was going to serve us. The disadvantage of psychological hideout chess were also considerable. For one thing, we couldn't hide anything but our person and what our person could carry in this sort of maneuver. Anything as heavy as a wooden chest filled with gold coins that we had stashed in our physical hideout would slow us down too much for the psychological hideout gambit. The solution might be, proposed Schlezzy, to carry only as many gold coins as to make gold necklaces, braces, hollowed out school hats, and walking sticks filled with coins. And then these accoutrements to slow us down, of course, so we had to practice. Nomads had practiced carrying their wealth and jewelry on their bodies for thousands of years. But we had only a few days to figure it out before our enemies saw that we moved like turtles under the weight. Well, maybe I said the perfect hideout was a combination of geographical, architectural, and psychological. We would first find an impregnable hideout for our treasure, and then we would practice the psychological moves discussed. Later, when we had confused our would-be captors at the speed of lights that we, as Jewish children, thought of as our birthright, then our hunters had collapsed from exhaustion, we would find our way to physical hideouts and take as much as we needed to eat and improve our safety. "There is another problem," said Schlezzy. "Namely, that in order to improve our safety, we have to clear a number of borders. First, there is the very wall we're hiding in, which has drunk and armed hostiles at its base. Then there is getting through the courtyard itself without being seen by the neighbors. Then, once we get out of the courtyard, we have to go through the old city, which is full of eyes looking for us. And then, if we successfully get away from the eyes, there are the two fortified walls that surround the city, the crumbling stone one from the 17th century and the brick stone wall with the guild towers built in the 18th century. And if somehow we get through these, we have to clear the moat, which is inhabited by insane leprous dragons. And if we're successful, a big if, we have to reach the Danube River at night by walking across 2 kilometers of mined fields, swim across the Danube, unless we could improvise a raft with branches from trees, and when we cross the Danube, we still have to hide until we reach what people called the Iron Curtain, an impediment made of actual iron, and it thus presented us with a nearly insurmountable problem. Yes, I said that's all true, my friend, but these are problems we can solve because kids like us were invented for such challenges. And if we solved all that, all we have to do is use our gold coins to buy a stone castle on an inaccessible mountain cliff somewhere in the Swiss Alps and surround it with defenses that would be absolutely unbreachable by Ilse or Schlesi's father. By the time the full moon started its descent into the morning sky and the drunks below had quit howling anti-Semitic insults at the cleverness of the Rosenbergs who had hidden their treasure so well the whole secret police of the region had been unable to find it, we were getting sleepy. Schlesi said, too. And by the time the full moon started its descent into the morning sky and the drunks below truly, truly quit, I stayed awake just long enough to think about Nemo. My hot dog, my schnauzer. I still had to rescue Nemo. He would be of invaluable help to us as we made our escape from hideout to the Swiss Alps. Dogs have an incredible sense of smell, for one thing, which is why, incidentally, I haven't figured out why he hadn't just come back.